going to the Tower of London, one of the great attractions of the city. Subway is what we call it in America, but in England it's called the Tube. In England, subway means an underground pedestrian tunnel. Arriving at the Tower of London, you get out at Tower Station, and we're here in the morning, so this is a great time to come in because there's no crowds, and we can gather around the yeoman warder if we choose to and listen to their stories on the history, or you can just walk around on your own inside this medieval fortress. Circular staircases everywhere. This leads us out to the castle wall with its crenellated gun slots and a fantastic view of Tower Bridge. When you're visiting the tower, you don't have to climb up and down all these staircases. If you want to just basically remain on ground level, that's okay. But half the fun is climbing up and down and through the narrow medieval passageways and getting to sights like this. It's a Norman chapel at the top of the White Tower. It's the oldest example of Norman architecture in England, built about the year 1100. Here's a nice model of the entire tower complex, showing the White Tower in the center. That was the original structure here, surrounded by the other walls and towers. Originally constructed for William the Conqueror way back around the year 1080. It has since grown and expanded and taken the shape that you see here today by about the 1400s. The Tower of London has served a wide variety of purposes over the years. It's been a fortress, a royal residence, the place where the crown jewels are stored, a state prison and site of execution, and an arsenal. The garrison was stationed here and their weapons were stored. There's old pistols, old cannons and muskets. We have suits of armor, swords and spears and lances. It's a phenomenal collection, first started by Henry VIII and consolidated later by Charles II. Here you'll find crossbows, elephant guns, whaling cannons, helmets made in Austria, just an enormous variety of weapons. Gives you some idea of how bloody life would have been back in the Middle Ages and the days of the Renaissance, when kings were fighting each other and crossing the oceans with their navies, and the Spanish with their armada were trying to invade England. It took the force of power to maintain the sovereignty of the kingdom. And it's all on display here at the tower, including this and several other suits of armor personally made for Henry VIII. And naturally, there's a gift shop as you're exiting the White Tower, with a nice variety of memorabilia on sale. Then we go into the Jewel House. You'll notice we don't have any line because we've come in the morning. If you come in the afternoon, you'll probably line up for an hour to get into the Tower of London and then wait for another hour to see the jewels. But look, it's worth it. You glide along on this moving sidewalk and get a fabulous view. It's like being on a conveyor belt. And you'll see the Imperial State Crown of Elizabeth II. It was worn for the return from Westminster Abbey and on various state occasions. Isn't that the extreme vision of what you think a crown should be? But even more spectacular is this. It's the Star of Africa, the largest cut diamond in the world. And we have the second largest cut diamond in the world embedded in this crown, the largest being 530 carats. Both of them cut from a single stone. The Tower of London is like a Hollywood movie version of what the perfect castle should be. It has everything you want to see. Once you've seen the Tower of London, you don't really have to go out into the British countryside looking for other castles, although that's fun to do as well. The Tower of London has it all, including these Tudor houses. Some of the higher officials live inside those Tudor houses. In fact, there's 45 guards, the yeoman warders, who actually live in here full-time.